What do we imagine when we hear the phrase giant ship? A cruise ship with countless decks and thousands of passengers, a tanker or a cargo ship that cuts across the blue surface like a whale, or something epic like the mighty battleships of World War II or modern nuclear aircraft carriers? And what if I say that these ships are all big, of course, but not the biggest? Not nearly the biggest. How much do they weigh? 100,000 tons? 150? 250? The hero of today's story next to them seems to be a building hanging over small houses. It has a length of almost half a kilometer, the height of a 30-story building, and a displacement of 600,000 tons, an indicator of a good fleet. Meet the Prelude, a new explanation of the meaning of the word huge. But what is this steel monster and why was it built? The first thing to say is that the Prelude is not quite an ordinary ship. It is not a military cruiser, not a tanker, not quite a tanker, not a cargo ship, and certainly not a cruise ship. The official name of the ship is Prelude FLNG, that is, floating liquid natural gas platform. In fact, it is a floating LNG plant. The rest of the story will answer the question. The sea, it seems, has not yet swallowed all the land due to global warming. Why build a floating platform? The sea, of course, did not swallow the world, but it must be admitted that this giant was built not from a good life. What is an LNG plant? A classic one. It is an intermediate link between the complex for the production of natural gas and transports carrying this gas to customers. Since the gas itself is gaseous, it is pointless to fill it into tankers in such a state. The required amount simply doesn't fit. The LNG plant, obviously by its name, is engaged in the processing of fuel from a gaseous to a liquid state, significantly increasing its density and therefore the amount in the volume available to gas carriers. You'd think this is a success. You extract the gas, liquefy it, and load it onto ships. But times are changing. LNG plants like these are incredibly complex and expensive structures. If you have a gas field capable of producing a huge amount of blue fuel for several decades, go ahead. The problem is that the era of easy extraction of natural resources is coming to an end. Huge fields are becoming more and more rare. The newly discovered ones are either not so large or are located in places that are rather difficult for extraction and processing. Many of them are located at sea, and the creation of infrastructure with pipelines stretching from the seabed to the plant, tens or even hundreds of kilometers away, makes construction crazy expensive and difficult. Then the engineers had an obvious idea: to create a floating plant and, instead of building pipes, simply bring it to the gas field, something like an oil platform. Plus, the plant can be made mobile and, after depletion, moved to another location, rather than shutting it down, simply leaving the billion-dollar facility to be torn apart by time and corrosion. This would significantly reduce costs, making it profitable to mine in places where previously they tried not to meddle. The idea was greenlit by Royal Dutch Shell in 2011. It was assumed that the plant would be able to arrive at offshore fields, extract and produce about 5.3 million tons of hydrocarbons. The problem was that the LNG plant is, to put it mildly, large, and you can't load it so easily on a ship. Shell invested tremendous effort in research and development, trying to make the processing line as light and compact as possible. And, in spite of their very serious successes, the plant was still quite large, its mass reaching 260,000 tons, the mass of two nuclear-powered aircraft carriers. And this is just the plant, without the ship platform itself. Nevertheless, 260,000, being a huge figure, is more or less realizable. Seeing the prospects, partners from the energy industry joined Shell. The prospects were at the level of risks. The cost of the project, according to various estimates, ranged from $10.8 to $12.6 billion, but if successful, the price was worthwhile. The problem of lack of experience, and such things were never built before, was solved by creating the TCS consortium, which included the Korean industrial giant Samsung Heavy Industries and the French engineering corporation Technip. Technip is responsible for the design and installation of the plant, while Samsung is, in fact, building the giant ship. Construction began at the Samsung plant near Busan. As it turned out, in general, few shipyards in the world are able to master what they were going to build. Nevertheless, the work was carried out quickly. The hull of the ship, named Prelude, was assembled and launched at the end of 2013, but its path was still far from completion. The most difficult thing was to mount the plant itself, equipment, and all the modules on it. About 5,000 people worked on the ship every day, just the engineers on one ship. Of course, cooperation was not limited to the union of the described companies. The highly complex anchor system for the ship was created in the United Arab Emirates. The chains for it were transported from Spain. The equipment for production, including 7 wells and lines for lifting gas from the bottom, was made in Malaysia and Australia. And control systems were developed by specialists from the United States. So, let's take a closer look at the ship. Prelude FLNG is a monster 488 meters, 1601 feet long, 74 meters, 242 feet wide, 105 meters, 344 feet high, and with 600,000 tons of displacement. It could be compared with some famous ships, for example the Titanic, but here the dimensions are so big that you can probably count in Titanics. And so, the Prelude is almost as long as two Titanics, 2.5 Titanics wide, another 2 Titanics high, and in terms of displacement, almost 12 Titanics. And despite the gigantic size, the engineers of Shell and partners had to work hard to fit the plant on the ship. They succeeded. Prelude is equipped with a quite worthy gas liquefaction complex, which without much reduction in functionality, they managed to shrink by about 25% compared to the same plant on the ground. The main gas processing complex is located on the upper decks above the ship's hull. It is divided into 14 modules, some of the elements of which are located not next to each other like on the ground, but one above the other. This is what gave Prelude the height of a 33-story building. The increase in compactness and reliability was facilitated by the new technology of the refrigerant, which in fact cools the gas for compression to minus 160 degrees Celsius. Also for the sake of compactness, the pressure in the liquefaction complex was increased by about 30%. For storage of liquefied gas before shipment was given the space inside the ship under the plant. There are 6 huge tanks with a capacity of 220,000 cubic meters of fuel. This is enough for the extraction, processing, storage, and unloading of fuel on gas carriers about once a week. Considering how much energy all this industrial beauty consumes, the sources must match. Generation at the Prelude is performed by a group of huge steam turbines, powered by 7 boilers and connected to 3 40 megawatt generators. Such a power plant, as well as the transition of the cooling system from air to water, reduced the size of the structure but increased the consumption of the vital fluid. About 50,000 tons of water are driven through the ship per hour. Again, the displacement of Titanic was 52,000 tons. The ship, of course, has propulsion. It is nevertheless not a barge. 3 6700 horsepower Rolls-Royce USL 455 azimuth electric engines are responsible for movement and, more importantly, orientation. To fix the platform above the gas production plant, a complex anchor system is used, which at the bottom is connected not with the usual anchors but with powerful supports on driven piles that go 65 meters into the bottom. This is enough for Prelude to be able to maintain its position, even in the face of severe storms. After all, this is the sea, and it is not enough to rely on dimensions alone. In 2017, the ship was ready and went to its place of service. A gas field in the Indian Ocean, north of Australia, has been identified a long time ago. The ship will have to arrive and take up a production position over the Prelude field, after which it was actually named. It is assumed that it will work here for the next 2 decades. When the blue fuel runs out there, the ship can be quickly moved to one of several promising fields in the same region. There is no need to dismantle the old plant and build new ones. The crew of the ship, for all its size, is only 240 people. The figure is even a little embarrassing. You'd expect a few thousand. But automation does its job. A crowd of people is simply not needed here. Shift work is assumed, several weeks on board, several weeks on the ground. Apart from obviously sea transport, a group of helicopters of different types is responsible for transportation. The Airbus H-255, Sikorsky S-92, sometimes the AW-139. Shell's offshore fleet is quite diverse. There are two large helipads on the ship for them. The example of the Prelude ship made the concept of floating LNG plants quite interesting. Shell continues to actively work on their brainchild. They have already presented a further development of the concept, calling it generic FLNG, with even greater working power and dimensions. In 2016, Dayu completed the construction of another ship for the Malaysian Petronas. Their version is slightly smaller, but in essence similar. Several other companies are actively considering the idea of abandoning the construction of coastal plants in favor of offshore platforms. Considering that the technology is already more or less worked out, and the production of such ships in the amount of more than one will be cheaper, this idea seems quite sensible. So there is a possibility that soon there will be several such floating monsters. Perhaps we are at the beginning of an era of even more gigantic ships. And with this shocking news, our story ends today. Comment what you think about this ship. Like and subscribe to the channel. There's still a lot of interesting things on the horizon.